Chapter 11, Saving, Capital Accumulation, and Output. This chapter focuses on the effects of the saving rate on the level and growth rate of output. Since the 1970s, US saving rate, the ratio of saving to GDP, has averaged only 17% compared to 23% for Germany and 29% in Japan. Would a higher US saving rate have led to higher US growth rate over the period? Would increasing the US saving rate lead to a sustained higher US growth in the future? The answer is no. Remember, over long periods, an economy's growth rate does not depend on its saving rate. It does not appear that a higher saving rate would have led to higher US growth rate over the last 50 years. Nor should we expect that an increase in the saving rate will lead to sustained higher US growth in the future. This conclusion does not mean, however, that we should not be concerned about the low US saving rate. Even if the saving rate does not permanently affect the growth rate, it does affect the level of output and the standard of living. An increase in saving rate would lead to higher growth for some time and eventually to a higher standard of living in the United States. Chapter 11 Outline. Section 11.1 looks at the interactions between output and capital. Section 11.2 looks at the implications of alternative saving rates. Section 11.3 plugs in numbers to give a better sense of the magnitudes involved. Section 11.4 extends our discussion to take into account not only physical but also human capital. If you remember one basic message from this chapter, it should be: capital accumulation increases output but cannot by itself sustain growth. Section 11.1, Interactions between output and capital. Output in the long run depends on two relations. The amount of capital determines the amount of output being produced. The amount of output produced determines the amount of saving, which in turn determines the amount of capital being accumulated over time. Together, these two relations, which are represented in Figure 11.1 on the next slide, determine the evolution of output and capital over time. In Figure 11.1, the green arrow going from the box labeled capital stock to the box labeled output slash income captures the first relation from capital to output. The blue arrow going from the output slash income box to the box called saving slash investment, and the purple arrows going from saving investment box to the box called change in capital stock capture the two parts of the second relation, from output to saving and investment, and from investment to the change in capital stock. The illustration shows the amount of capital stock helping in determining the amount of output being produced. The amount of output being produced further helps in determining the amount of saving or investment, which in turn determines the change in the capital stock being accumulated over time. Let us look at each relation in turn. The effects of capital on output. Recall from chapter 10, equation 10.3 gives y over n equals uppercase F within bracket k over n comma 1 bracket close. Substitute lowercase f within bracket k over n to be equal to uppercase F within bracket k over n comma 1 bracket close. Assume that population, participation rate, and unemployment rate are constant, so n is constant and there is no technological progress, So lowercase f does not change over time. Then yt over n equals lowercase f within bracket kt over n bracket close as equation 11.1. By assuming n as constant, we are assuming employment to be constant. By assuming n to be constant, it becomes easier to focus on how capital accumulation affects growth. With these two assumptions, n is constant and lowercase f does not change over time, our first relation between output and capital per worker from the production side can be written as equation 11.1 listed above. We have introduced time indexes for output and capital, but not for labor n, which we assume to be constant and so does not need a time index. Equation 11.1 tells us that from the production side, the level of capital per worker determines the level of output per worker, and that higher capital per worker leads to higher output per worker. The effects of output on capital accumulation. To derive the relation between output and capital accumulation, we proceed in two steps. First, we derive the relation between output and investment. Then we derive the relation between investment and capital accumulation. Output and investment. To derive the relation between output and investment, we make these three assumptions. First, we continue to assume that the economy is closed. This means that investment I is equal to saving, the sum of private saving S and public saving T minus G. I equals S plus T minus G. 2. Public saving T minus G is 0. So I equals S. 3. Private saving is proportional to income. Uppercase S equals lowercase s times y. The parameter lowercase s is the saving rate. It has a value between 0 and 1. This assumption captures two basic facts about saving. First, the saving rate does not appear to systematically increase or decrease as a country becomes richer. Second, richer countries do not appear to have systematically higher or lower saving rates than poorer ones. Combining these two relations and introducing time indexes gives a simple relation between investment and output. IT equals lowercase s times YT. Investment is proportional to output. The higher output is, the higher is saving, and so the higher is investment. Investment and capital accumulation. The second step relates investment, which is a flow, the new machines produced and new plants built during a given period, to capital, which is a stock, the existing machines and plants in the economy at a point in time. Equation 11.2 gives us the second relation between output and capital per worker. The evolution of the capital stock is kt plus 1 equals within bracket 1 minus delta times kt plus it, where kt plus 1 written as uppercase k with subscript lowercase t plus 1 refers to capital stock at the beginning of year t plus 1. Delta is assumed to be the rate at which capital depreciates per year. Equivalently, 1 minus delta of the capital stock remains intact from 1 year to the next. The capital stock at the beginning of year t plus 1, kt plus 1, is equal to the capital stock at the beginning of year t, which is still intact in year t plus 1, that is 1 minus delta within bracket times kt plus the new capital stock put in place during year t, i.e. investment during year t, it. Replace investment by the above expression IT equals lowercase s times yt and divide both sides by n. K kt plus 1 over n equals within bracket 1 minus delta multiplied by kt over n plus lowercase s multiplied by yt over n, or kt plus 1 over n minus kt over n equals lowercase s times yt over n minus delta times kt over n, equation 11.2. The change in the capital stock per worker represented by the difference between the two terms on the left is equal to saving per worker represented by the first term on the right minus depreciation represented by the second term on the right. This equation gives us the second relation between output and capital per worker. From the saving side, the level of output per worker determines the change in the level of capital per worker over time. The implications of alternative saving rates. We have derived two relations. From the production side, the level of capital per worker determines the level of output per worker, and that higher capital per worker leads to higher output per worker. From the saving side, the level of output per worker determines the change in the level of capital per worker over time. Dynamics of capital and output. We can now put the two relations derived in the previous section together and see how they determine the behavior of output and capital over time. This relation given in equation 11.3 describes what happens to capital per worker. Combining equations 11.1 and 11.2, we get kt plus 1 over n minus kt over n equals lowercase s times lowercase f within bracket kt over n minus delta times kt over n as equation 11.3. In words, change in capital from year t to year t plus 1 equals investment during year t minus depreciation during year t. This relation describes what happens to capital per worker. The change in capital per worker from this year to the next depends on the difference between two terms, investment per worker, the first term on the right. The level of capital per worker this year determines output per worker this year. Given the saving rate, output per worker determines the amount of saving per worker and thus investment per worker this year. Depreciation per worker, the second term on the right. The capital stock per worker determines the amount of depreciation per worker this year. If investment per worker exceeds depreciation per worker, the change in capital per worker is positive. Capital per worker increases. Figure 11.2 shows capital and output dynamics. Equations 11.1 and 11.3 given below contain all the information we need to understand the dynamics of capital and output over time. Yt over n equals lowercase f within bracket kt over n, equation 11.1. And kt plus 1 over n minus kt over n equals lowercase s times lowercase f within bracket kt over n minus delta times kt over n, equation 11.3. In figure 11.2, output per worker is measured on the vertical axis and capital per worker is measured on the horizontal axis. In figure 11.2, look first at the curve representing output per worker, lowercase f times within bracket kt over n, as a function of capital per worker. Output per worker increases with capital per worker, but because of decreasing returns to capital, the effect is smaller the higher the level of capital per worker. Now, look at the two curves representing the two components on the right side of equation 11.3. The relation representing investment per worker has the same shape as the production function, except that it is lower by factor, lowercase s, the saving rate. Suppose the level of capital per worker is equal to k0 over n in figure 11.2. Output per worker is given by the vertical distance AB, and investment per worker is given by the vertical distance AC, which is equal to lowercase s times the distance AB. Thus, just like output per worker, investment per worker increases with capital per worker, but by less and less as capital per worker increases. The relation representing depreciation per worker is represented by a straight line. Depreciation per worker increases in proportion to capital per worker, so the relation is represented by a straight line with slope equal to delta. At the level of capital per worker, k0 over n, depreciation per worker is given by the vertical distance AD. The change in capital per worker is given by the difference between investment per worker and depreciation per worker. At k0 over n, the difference is positive. Investment per worker exceeds depreciation per worker by the distance CD equals AC minus DC, so capital per worker increases. For some level of capital per worker, K star over N, in figure 11.2, investment is just enough to cover depreciation and capital per worker remains constant. We see when capital and output are low to the left of K star over N, investment exceeds depreciation and capital increases. When capital and output are high to the right of K star over N, investment is less than depreciation and capital decreases. Think, for example, a country that loses part of its capital stock, say as a result of bombing during a war. Thus, if the capital per worker falls below K star over N, then the country will experience a large increase in capital per worker and output per worker for some time. This is what happened after World War II to countries that had proportionately larger destructions of capital than losses of human lives. If a country starts instead from a high level of capital per worker from a point to the right of K star over N, then depreciation will exceed investment and output per worker and capital per worker will decrease. The initial level of capital per worker is too high to be sustained given the saving rate. This decrease in capital per worker will continue until the economy again reaches the point where investment is equal to depreciation and capital per worker is equal to K star over N. From then on, capital per worker and output per worker will remain constant. Let's look at the levels of output per worker and capital per worker to which the economy converges in the long run. The state in which output per worker and capital per worker are no longer changing is called the steady state of the economy. Setting the left side of equation 11.3 given below equal to 0, kt plus 1 over n minus kt over n equals lowercase s times lowercase f within brackets kt over n bracket close minus delta times kt over n equation 11.3, we get equation 11.4, lowercase s times lowercase f within bracket k star over n bracket close equals delta times k star over n as equation 11.4. The steady state value of capital per worker is such that the amount of saving per worker is sufficient to cover depreciation of capital stock per worker. Y star over N equals lowercase f within bracket K star over N bracket close as equation 11.5. Given steady state capital per worker K star over N, the steady state value of output per worker, Y star over N, is given by the production function equation 11.5. We now have all the elements we need to discuss the effects of the saving rate on output per worker, both over time and in steady state. Focus: capital accumulation and growth in France in the aftermath of World War II. France suffered heavy losses in capital when World War II ended in 1945. The growth model predicts that France would experience high capital accumulation and output growth for some time. From 1946 to 1950, French real GDP indeed grew at 9.6% per year. So how does the saving rate affect the growth rate of output per worker? Our analysis leads to a three-part answer listed here. 1. The saving rate has no effect on the long-run growth rate of output per worker, which is equal to 0. 2. The saving rate determines the level of output per worker in the long run. 3. An increase in the saving rate will lead to higher growth rate of output per worker for some time, but not forever. Figure 11.3 shows the effects of different saving rates. Other things being equal, countries with a higher saving rate will achieve higher output per worker in the long run. Figure 11.3 illustrates this point. Consider two countries with the same production function, the same level of employment, and the same depreciation rate, but with different saving rates, say S0 and S1 greater than S0. Figure 11.3 draws their common production function, F within bracket AT over N, and the functions showing saving / investment per worker as a function of capital per worker for each of the two countries. S0, a lowercase f within bracket kt over n, and S1, lowercase f within bracket kt over n. In the long run, the country with saving rate S0 will reach the level of capital per worker K0 over n and output per worker Y0 over n. The country with saving rate S1 will reach the higher levels K1 over n and Y1 over n. Figure 11.4 shows the effects of an increase in the saving rate on output per worker in an economy without technological progress. The movement of output per worker is plotted against time in figure 11.4. Output per worker is initially constant at level Y0 over N. After an increase in the saving rate at time T, output per worker increases for some time until it reaches Y1 over N and the growth rate returns to zero. Once investment equals depreciation, growth ends. Figure 11.5 extends figure 11.4 by plotting the effect of an increase in the saving rate on an economy with positive technological progress. The figure uses a logarithmic scale to measure output per worker. The vertical axis of the graph is labeled output per worker, Y over N, log scale, and the horizontal axis is labeled time. It follows that an economy in which output per worker grows at a constant rate is represented by a line with a slope equal to that growth rate. At the initial saving rate S0, the economy moves along AA. If at time T, the saving rate increases to S1, the economy experiences higher growth for some time until it reaches its new higher path BB. The growth rate then becomes the same as before the increase in the saving rate. That is, the slope of BB is the same as the slope of AA. The saving think rate and consumption. What matters to people is not how much is produced, but how much they consume. Governments can affect the saving rate by changing public saving, budget surplus, or by using taxes to affect private saving. Golden rule level of capital. The level of capital associated with the saving rate that yields the highest level of consumption in steady state. Governments should aim for the savings rate that creates the golden rule level of capital. This level of capital results in the highest level of steady state consumption. This golden rule level of capital argument is illustrated in figure 11.6, which plots consumption per worker in steady state on the vertical axis against the saving rate on the horizontal axis. A saving rate equal to zero implies a capital stock per worker equal to zero, a level of output per worker equal to zero, and by implication, a level of consumption per worker equal to zero. For S between 0 and SG, written as lowercase letter s with subscript uppercase letter g, G for golden rule. A higher saving rate leads to higher capital per worker, higher output per worker, and higher consumption per worker. For S larger than SG, increases in saving rate still lead to higher values of capital per worker and output per worker, but now they lead to lower values of consumption per worker. This is because the increase in output is more than offset by the increase in depreciation as a result of the larger capital stock. For S equals 1, consumption per worker is equal to 0, capital per worker and output per worker are high, but all of the output is used just to replace depreciation, leaving nothing for consumption. Empirical evidence indicates that OECD countries are typically below their golden rule level of capital. Summary. For a saving rate between zero and the golden rule level, a higher saving rate leads to higher capital per worker, higher output per worker, and higher consumption per worker. For a saving rate greater than the golden rule level, a higher saving rate still leads to higher capital per worker and output per worker, but lower consumption per worker. This means that, in practice, governments face a trade-off. An increase in the saving rate leads to lower consumption for some time, but higher consumption later. So what should governments do? How close to the golden rule should they try to get? That depends on how much weight they put on the welfare of current generations who are more likely to lose from policies aimed at increasing the saving rate versus the welfare of future generations who are more likely to gain. These intergenerational issues are at the forefront of the debate on Social Security reform in the United States. Focus. Social Security, saving, and capital accumulation in the United States. Social Security, introduced in 1935, has led to a lower U.S. saving rate and thus lower capital accumulation and lower output per person in the long run. Social Security is a pay-as-you-go system that taxes workers and redistributes the tax contributions as benefits to current retirees, resulting in lower private saving as workers anticipate receiving benefits when they retire. An alternative is a fully funded system that pays back the principal plus interest to the workers when they retire, resulting in lower private saving but higher public saving as the system invests their contributions in financial assets. Some economists and politicians have suggested that U.S. should shift to a fully funded system because the U.S. saving rate is too low and that funding the social security system would increase it. Martin Feldstein, an economist at Harvard and an advocate of such a shift, has concluded that it could lead to a 34% increase of the capital stock in the long run. Section 11.3, getting a sense of magnitudes. How big an impact does a change in the saving rate have on output in the long run? For how long and by how much does an increase in the saving rate affect growth? How far is the United States from the golden rule level of capital? To get a better sense of the answers to these questions, let's now make more specific assumptions, plug in some numbers, and see what we get. Assume the production function, represented by lowercase letter f, is given by equation 11.6 below. Y equals under root k times under root n, equation 11.6. Dividing both sides by n, we get y over n equals, within bracket, under root k times under root n, bracket close, divided by n, equals under root k divided by under root n, equals under root of k over n. Output per worker equals the square root of capital per worker. The production function f, relating output per worker to capital per worker, is given by f within bracket kt over n, bracket close, equals under root of k over n. So that equation 11.3, kt plus 1 over n minus kt over n equals s times f within bracket kt over n minus delta times kt over n becomes kt plus 1 over n minus kt over n equals s times under root of kt over n minus delta kt over n, as equation 11.7, which describes the evolution of capital over time. The effects of the saving rate on steady state output. Equation 11.7 implies that capital per worker in the steady state, k star over n, becomes k star over n equals s over delta, the whole term squared, as equation 11.8. Steady state capital per worker is equal to the square of the ratio of the saving rate to the depreciation rate. Combining equations 11.6 and 11.8 gives the steady state output per worker y star over n equals under root of k star over n, which is equal to s over delta a squared, under root of that equals s over delta, as equation 11.9. A higher saving rate and a lower depreciation rate both lead to higher state capital per worker, shown by equation 11.8, and higher steady state output per worker, shown by equation 11.9. Assume initially that the depreciation rate and saving rate are equal to 10%, then the capital per worker and output per worker in the steady state will be equal to 1. Now suppose that the saving rate doubles to 20%. Following equation 11.8, capital per worker increases from 1 to 4, and from equation 11.9, output per worker doubles from 1 to 2. So in the long run, output per worker doubles when the saving rate doubles. Figure 11.7a, the dynamic effects of an increase in the saving rate from 10% to 20% on the level and the growth rate of output per worker. Figure 11.7a plots the level of output per worker against time. Y over n increases from its initial value of 1 in year 0 to a steady state value of 2 in the long run. Figure 11.7a clearly shows that the adjustment to the new, higher, long-run equilibrium takes a long time. It is only 40% complete after 10 years and 63% complete after 20 years. Put another way, the increase in the saving rate increases the growth rate of output per worker for a long time. Figure 11.7b, the dynamic effects of an increase in the saving rate from 10 to 20% on the level and the growth rate of output per worker. The vertical axis is labeled growth rate of output per worker percent and ranges from 0 to 5 in increments of 1. The horizontal axis is labeled years and ranges from 0 to 50 in increments of 10. Figure 11.7b shows growth of output per worker is largest in the beginning and then decreases over time. The difference between investment and depreciation is largest at the beginning. This is why capital accumulation and in turn output growth are highest at the beginning. The average annual growth rate is 3.1% for the first 10 years and 1.5% for the next 10. A line graph shows the effects of an increase in the saving rate on output growth. The US saving rate and the golden rule. What is the saving rate that would maximize steady state consumption per worker? Recall that in steady state, consumption is what is left after enough is put aside to maintain a constant level of capital. More formally, in steady state, consumption per worker is equal to output per worker minus depreciation per worker. In the steady state, consumption per worker is C over N equals Y over N minus delta times K over N. Given equations 11.8 and 11.9, the steady state consumption per worker is C over N equals S over delta minus delta times S over delta within brackets squared equals S times 1 minus S and the whole term divided by delta. Table 11.1 gives the steady state values of capital per worker, output per worker, and consumption per worker for different values of the saving rate and for a depreciation rate equal to 10%. Steady state consumption per worker is largest when S equals 1 over 2. In other words, the golden rule level of capital is associated with a saving rate of 50%. Below that level, increases in the saving rate lead to an increase in long-run consumption per worker. Average U.S. saving rate since 1970 has been 17%. So we can be quite confident that at least in the US, an increase in the saving rate would increase both output per worker and consumption per worker in the long run. Some researchers argue that China with a saving rate of close to 50% may indeed be on the other side of the golden rule. Focus. Nudging U.S. households to save more. U.S. households save little. The household saving rate, defined as the ratio of household saving to household disposable income, has averaged 6% since 2000. Successive governments have tried to increase the saving rate by giving tax breaks, which made saving more attractive, but with limited success. Nobel laureate Richard Thaler, considered one of the founders of behavioral economics, designed a program to increase saving based on human behavior. Richard Thaler and Shlomo Benozzi designed an approach called Save More Tomorrow, aimed at dealing with these two issues in human behavior. People put too much weight on immediate consumption, and two, people procrastinate. In the Save More Tomorrow approach, people were asked to make decisions long before implementing them So people would not have to increase saving and decrease consumption today, but only commit to do it in the future, something psychologically much less costly. Second, and even more importantly, the saving plan option rather than the no saving plan option was the default in the choice of plans. This plan has achieved enormous success. Section 11.4, Physical versus Human Capital. We have concentrated so far on physical capital, machines, plants, office buildings, and so on. But economies have another type of capital. The skills of the workers in the economy, or what economists call human capital. An economy with many highly skilled workers is likely to be much more productive than an economy in which most workers cannot read or write. Human capital, denoted by uppercase letter H, represents the set of skills of the workers in the economy built through education and on-the-job training. The production function with human capital becomes Y over N equals F within brackets K over N, comma H over N, bracket close, with plus sign under K over N and H over N, as equation 11.10. Equation 11.10 says the level of output per worker depends on both the level of physical capital per worker, K over N, and the level of human capital per worker, H over N. The plus sign under K over N and H over N means that an increase in capital per worker, K over N, leads to an increase in output per worker and an increase in the average level of skill, H over N, also leads to more output per worker. Countries that save more or spend more on education can achieve higher steady state levels of output per worker. What is the relative importance of human capital and of physical capital in the determination of output per worker? In the US, spending on formal education is about 6.5% of GDP. This is between one-third and one-half of the gross investment rate for physical capital, which is around 17%. Recent studies conclude that investment in physical capital and in education play roughly similar roles in the determination of output. Endogenous growth. We learn that a country that saves more or spends more on education will achieve a higher level of output per worker in steady state. We did not say that by saving or spending more on education, a country can sustain permanently higher growth of output per worker. However, following the lead of Nobel Prize-winning economists Robert Lucas of the University of Chicago and Paul Romer of New York University, researchers have explored the possibility that the joint accumulation of physical capital and human capital might actually be enough to sustain growth. Models that generate steady growth, even without technological progress, are called models of endogenous growth, in contrast to the model we saw in previous sections of this chapter. The growth rate depends, even in the long run, on variables such as the saving rate and the rate of spending on education.